Hello, everybody. We are the creators of the CCFC television series, and we are here to provide you with some commentary on our 8th episode we've made together.
Yeah, I'm sure you know what it's called by now, but it's CCFC Attempts at Counterculture Future.
Yeah.
We didn't work very hard at it, and it's already being hailed as one of the top videos of all time.
Yeah.
Comedy or otherwise. So we thought, why not provide some backstory on the, you know, the process of making it.
Right, there's just a lot of brilliance that you don't see when you view this video. As just the common viewer, it's understandable.
You don't get it. How can you?
Yeah, it's clear that some things will just go over your head, and we really want to bring you through the process of making it.
We want to put you... You'll never get into our heads, but this is maybe the closest that you'll come to being a genius yourself.
Right, exactly. And... I mean, it's pretty amazing we pulled through and made this whole video.
A lot of hard conditions.
Yeah. We want you to understand the process we really went through to give you this comedic and dramatic brilliance. I mean, this is somewhat of a thriller, this episode.
It's everything. It's our magnum opus. That's what most people are saying.
We're going to watch it with us, and listen to our commentary, because I'm sure we'll have some insightful things to say. Thank you.
And it's genius. Goodbye.
That was great. So, yeah, this first scene is a very common scene amongst what we do.
Yeah.
Same alignment.
You got your two shot, is what they call it in the biz.
Yep.
That's when two people are in the shot.
And it's a long shot. So it can capture our beauty in full, of course.
I think the first sign of our genius here is that incest story, that wasn't in the book, that was kind of a personal tale. And I think it's good to... I think there's real sign of genius when you can show, bring in some personal stuff. Not me, of course, but a distant friend who, thank God, I'm not friends with anymore. But he had some incest going on in his family.
Yeah, that's always weird when that happens.
Yeah, I was like, I'm done with you, buddy.
Right.
And, but he fucked his son.
Well, I think it's good that you brought this up in the video. It's because, you know, film is, it's really the most potent medium in terms of getting people news.
Right. I didn't want to say it just to be funny, although clearly I was very funny. I meant it to be a showing of how bad, you know, these things happen. And I wanted to get the news out there and also be very funny, which I was. Let's keep watching.
Now, I mean, it's the kind of thing where we bring up a very relevant topic here. The porno books, there was just that book out that it was referred to as mommy porn.
Right.
What was that book called?
I think it was like, Let's Do Some Mommy Porn. And
was that what it was called?
Yeah, it was called Let's Do Some Mommy Porn.
I thought it was called, no, Touch of Grey is what I'm talking about.
50 Shades of Grey?
Oh, yes, 50 Shades of Grey.
Oh, Mommy Porn, that was the book I wrote. I'm sorry.
Oh, yes, that was a great book.
That was on the shelves for 2 days?
Yeah.
Sold more than expected,
I'm pretty sure that book that you wrote went over everyone's heads because,
Saying, that's why, they took it off after 2 days. But we still got a couple of copies sold, which was great and unexpected, and they went well.
I'm sure both of those copies were from Ivy League professors.
Yeah, one was. And one was from the weird incest friend I was talking about before.
Oh,
yeah.
Interesting.
And he sold it, he told me. But.
So the kids are reading the book?
Oh, yeah, maybe the weird kids on campus.
So, yeah, this is kind of relevant as well. So, everything we're saying here kind of fits into what was going on at that time when we made this episode.
Mm-hmm.
Here we're talking about how the children at my school must have read the book and took action based off of what they read. And obviously, it was to my misfortune, because some of this is true that we talk about, and this is true. I was molested a little bit. I had a bad college experience for the first semester. You know, bullying happens, and sexual molestation happens.
Yeah.
And this is the kind of thing where kids read a book, and that's what happens. They take action based off what they read. I mean, media will influence kids, and, you know, who knows what will happen.
And I think this scene just was a great capsule of that whole message.
Yeah. And that's exactly what I'm talking about. Film is such a potent form. I mean, that'll influence people. It makes up who you are, and that's what we're doing. We're just influencing the world.
Yeah. This video changed the world. I just want to put that out there early in the video. So we
can, yeah, I mean...
I just want to clear that up.
Yeah, I think that goes without saying.
Sure, yeah. That's, that should go without saying.
It's nice to hear it time and time again, but...
Yeah.
Let's stick with what we know.
Yeah.
Like, we did a talent show.
Now, these were referring back to our other genius works. We just thought they needed more attention. They all can always use more attention because they're so great.
Right. So this character who did the stand-up comedy is a very funny man.
Yeah.
He costs a little bit of money to have him come on set and act, but...
And he's a little bit of a dick behind the scenes. Yeah. Like, just, I don't know. He pretends to be so great, but really, we're the great ones. I don't know why he's pretending to be so great.
Right.
So it's hard to work with when you're the good one and he thinks he's great. But we got the video done, which was cool. Mm-hmm. And he's all right in it.
I love that when we flash back to the
music episode. That was good.
Yeah.
That we really proved our instrumental skills amongst all our other skills. So that was cool to show some more sides of us that are nothing but positive.
Yeah, and it's really amazing. This show can be anything. Oh, here's from the...
This is where we showcase our acting skills to the fullest, a wide range. Let's just sit back and watch for a second. That was without a special effects team. I just want to clarify that. That was just us. And you were probably thinking as you were watching it, how many guys did they have? Do they have a crew of hundreds? No. Nope.
That's
exactly
right.
No.
We didn't.
No, just us.
I mean, this is indie filmmaking at its finest.
Yeah. This could pass off for the... biggest blockbusters you watched this summer, which is great for us because we're so great. Let's keep watching.
So I think it was Adam who thought of the cool cabbies thing, and I just thought it was brilliant immediately. The independent cab service,
right?
Kind of what people are trying to do today in hard times, economic recession and things like that.
Right.
You do what you can, you make up these indie jobs and and again, very relevant to
we're just trying to speak for the people, and I think this video does nothing but demonstrate that.
Yes. And then we pull out of the driveway.
Great shot.
I love that shot so much. And then this is
there's a scene coming up that's really funny, which we're thinking about, but this is a great shot.
I love this scene where it just gets so funny here.
Yeah.
Oh my gosh. We start yelling to those people out there.
Fun fact, there are no people out on the street.
There were none. We were acting this out as if there were people. You know, it's hard to do because you go and you yell out the window as if there's people out there. And I think we sold it. All of our viewers thought there were...
It's like what Hollywood's greatest stars are doing in film. You know, like in stuff like Planet of the Apes. Like, there's no apes there.
Right.
They're just acting. We are as good, if not better, than those actors.
We're like a pretty cool cab service. We're a pretty
good cab
service. Let's keep watching. Hello, people! Hey!
Yeah, so we yell a lot of things. I just think this scene's hilarious. I mean, you heard me. I started laughing even before this scene came on.
Yeah,
I mean,
the video's so good that you're just thinking about stuff.
I'm thinking about what's going to happen.
Yeah.
Because we've seen it before.
We've seen
probably 100 times at this point.
Like everyone else,
yeah.
Just want to reiterate, all those lines, the hey and the come on, those were all improv, all not written lines. Beforehand, which I think is incredible. We could have written those down.
Right, yeah.
But the fact that we just came up with that shit in the middle of the scene is what's amazing about us as people, as filmmakers, yes. Writers.
I mean, that's exactly right. And so many comedy movies today, they write out the script and, right. And the actors just recite the lines. Yeah. But I mean, it's fucking organic the way we do
it. Is what it is.
Here.
I like to call it
amazing.
I like to call us verbal writers in the fact that we write verbally, like speaking.
And what I mean by organic, it comes out so naturally. It
right.
flows so well.
Not like in gardens. You didn't mean like we do
right,
stuff in gardens.
Right. No, no.
Yeah, yeah. No, we just do things naturally.
Yeah.
We're fucking geniuses. Let's keep watching. See, at this point, we've kind of failed a little bit. And this was hard to do because we don't do that in real life. So it's kind of hard to, like, act here because we're really acting to try and pretend like we've failed at something. Because we don't do that.
Right. And then we flash back, of course, to what that was CCFC Gets Canceled.
Where we put posters in a school. And we really went into that school.
Right.
And we put those posters up.
We put the posters up and... I mean, that was a great time. Oh, you see, this is
an on-location set. Yeah, also a music montage.
Yeah.
So two very cinematic techniques that we use.
Because
sometimes in movies, they'll go outside, and sometimes they'll use music. And we did both at the same time, which is hardly ever done, I think.
Right. And this shot's cool. It's a little crooked.
Right. Well, Dutch angle for you guys who are the film nerds, but you probably didn't get that. But it's a Dutch angle.
Yep.
You might be seeing more of those. You might not. That's
angle
the fun
of
it.
Dutch.
Yeah.
Classic stuff. I mean, obscure classic, of course.
Right.
It's not a classic amongst mainstream, but those people don't really know. And then the song we're using during this montage is actually a song by the Beatles.
Mm-hmm.
Baby, you can drive my car.
No. Maybe you didn't realize why we use the song. Let me explain it. In
right.
the montage here, we're driving a car. So we thought, let's.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And it's also for the cab service.
Right, yeah.
Where, you know, you can get into my car.
We hit you with a double meaning on that one. We hit you with
right.
a double meaning. I'm sorry if you didn't get it at first.
I'm pretty sure that
this is why we're doing the video, to clear stuff like this up.
Right. It's it's kind of double entendre. Right? That's what English
yeah.
philosophers will say,
yeah.
that we're using double entendre here.
We really ran.
And
that's not extras. That's
right.
not stunt doubles. We ran there.
And now this is, of course, a
first,
reference.
Yes. A reference
to a film from the 80s that everybody loves.
We perfectly jumped in time there, and we didn't use freeze frame. We stayed in midair, which was hard.
It was weird.
I think we're the first to do that in
yeah.
film history. I think we're the first.
The way we did it, we had strings hanging from the branches of trees above us.
Well, that's
and,
how we wait that's what we originally decided to do it, but then we realized we could just fly and stay in midair.
Oh, you're right.
So we were like, why not use the powers we have?
Right, right.
So we just stayed in midair. We just decided to stay in midair.
So supernatural things going on, Seth.
Yeah, that's fun. That's always fun to bring in the supernatural. We do that from time to time, and you'll probably see more of that later. So, yeah, look for it.
And then this scene is a little bit funny. We're just talking about how we're already wary
yeah.
of doing our jobs.
Right.
As if we get wary ever. I mean...
Yeah.
And
I believe now we're going to pick up the first customer?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So, yeah, we're in the car. And this was difficult to shoot because we're actually driving in these scenes. A lot
right.
of those... Hollywood producers will put a screen behind a car and put the actors in a car, and then it makes it appear as if they're driving, but they're not really driving.
Mm-hmm.
Everything we do is very genuine,
organic.
Real, organic. It's very natural stuff. So,
like, we had the money to use a green screen. We had all the money ever,
right.
but why We're trying to make a real thing.
We could have invested a lot in this movie, but we said, you know, let's stick to a low budget.
Because we want to make it real.
We want to make it real. Not everyone has the access to $1 million budget. So right. Let's not pull that bullshit. Yeah. I mean,
let's not be pretentious and, you know, like...
Some of these movies today, I mean, Scorsese just came out with that one. That was just... It's so over the top. It's,
right.
It's inaccessible to the common viewer.
Yeah.
And, I mean, is he speaking for us? No.
I don't think
so. He's speaking for one guy.
Yeah. We're speaking for the people here.
Was a wolf. That... I didn't really understand that part of the movie. He was a wolf man.
I think they cut off... Yeah, they cut out some scenes where he turned into a werewolf. We didn't cut out anything. This is all planned from the get-go. We knew what we were going to do. Scorsese was jumping around.
Yeah.
If you're going to have a part about the werewolf and you cut it out, don't put it in the title. Fucking idiot. Let's keep watching.
He's got to be on top of his stuff to, you know, call a taxi cab just for some morning work.
I bet he is.
All improv. I just want to say that again.
Oh, why don't you... Here, I think I can put into navigation. Hold on. Oh.
I'm typing on a real GPS here.
So I'll just type in...
I'm not just hitting nothing.
Right.
And I say that it's a GPS that can track humans, but that was also acting. That's not a real GPS. That's not a real thing.
No, yeah, that's not a real invention that came out.
Yeah. Maybe now it will be, because I've influenced so many inventors and stuff with all my stuff.
Thinking the same exact thing. You'd be me to saying that.
Look out for it, and, you know, be ready.
Hmm. Now, I mean, the realism is really...
Yeah.
It really comes through here because this shot is so long.
Yeah.
Do we need to see you doing this for so long? No.
But I think we're really speaking to the people who use GPSs.
Right.
And they sit there.
Exactly.
And they type it out and there's mistakes because it's a hard machine to use.
It's so true. I mean.
So we're just trying to.
You get in your car, you try to use the GPS, you spend, you know, 10 minutes.
Maybe more.
Yeah, so we're at this point we're going to pick up the character who's yet to be revealed. I mean, this is kind of where the suspense in the episode begins.
Yeah. Is there going to be a person there when we pick him up? Is there not?
Is it going to be a monster of some sort?
A Wolf of Wall Street, maybe.
Right. So it's a source of horror is coming through as well.
Mystery, suspense.
Really interesting.
So we got three genres covered in this scene.
Yeah. And then, I turned down the street. I had to avoid a deer.
There was really a deer there.
Scary, yeah.
Yeah, that was weird and scary.
It was, I mean.
But we just kept acting through it, which is great for us. We're great.
Just full on method acting.
That was a real car that passed by.
Mm-hmm.
You do any skiing on Cherry Hill? Did
some now this is also coming from personal experience. This I used to live on a cherry hill. It wasn't a street, it was an actual hill. I lived in the Deutschland where there was a hill and there was a cherry. There was cherries on the hill. There was no cherry trees. I don't know where the cherries came from, but there was just a bunch of cherries lying around. And yeah, so I named it Cherry Hill. Right. And when I came to the States, a couple months ago, I don't know, it just stuck with me. So I used it in the video you're watching now.
Right, yeah. So we kind of did this for Adam. I mean, this was a very nostalgic conversation for him.
Yeah, it was a piece for my homeland.
Mm. And, yeah, I'm sure all those people who lived where you lived loved this scene. I mean, they were probably in celebration when we were talking about your homeland.
And I didn't live there my whole life. I was here when I thought I was going to live there, so I went there a couple months, and then I came back after I saw those fucking cherries on the ground.
Got attacked by a deer.
It was gross, so.
Yeah,
they get squished. And
yeah, and I didn't want to live there anymore because of it.
Bullshit.
But I still love it. You know, that's why I referenced it. You know, Nothing but respect for the Deutschland.
It was just nostalgia. I mean, obviously, you don't want to go back there anymore.
Fuck
but,
no.
Yeah, that's him.
But, yeah, it was great while it lasted.
Yeah. And, you know, good luck to the new owners. I should say that again. They're nice people. They're nice people.
So here is our character. You just saw his silhouette, and now he gets into the car. You as the viewer don't even know who this person is. And now we're pulling away.
Hey, sir. So what's going on tonight?
So he's in darkness right now. We have two lights on top of his head. His head is lit up, but really you're only seeing his silhouette.
I emailed you the address.
Yeah, I didn't get the email.
We made a conscious decision early on to not hide the voice. Like, we wanted him to speak or else it'd be a pretty awkward scene. So let's just disguise the face and he'll talk as normal. That was a conscious decision early on. That was not a mistake.
I don't really want to talk about it.
So this is actually pretty good actor, this man.
Right. While we're doing improv, we told him everything to say. Right, I want to make that clear. He's a good actor.
He's a good actor, right?
Did what he could, but he could not come up with a single line. There was a bunch of takes early on where we told him to improv, and he kept saying the same word. I think he said, like, ice, like, 1,000 times, and we were like, no, we gotta, like, make a scene out of this.
Right.
And he would just say nothing but ice, so we just had to write some stuff for him. That's our genius.
I mean, he's huge. He's been huge in the theater scene for a while now.
Yeah.
So we picked him up off that. I mean, this is actually his first
film piece. I saw him in Cats, originally.
Yeah, well, that was good. He did a little bit for Fiddler on the Roof, and
he was the janitor for both of those. And then he just hopped up on stage once.
What's that?
What?
Huh? Are you thinking of a funny thing that happened when
when he came up on stage, he wasn't supposed to be there. And he pretended in his custodial outfit to be one of the cats. And he was the obvious cat out of the bag because he was in a janitor outfit. So you knew, but he tried.
Such an amazing joke that you did there. That you just said.
Oh, thanks. It's just improv and genius at its finest.
My God.
Oh, God.
I mean, this is why these videos are so funny. We can just spitball like that.
Yeah.
This shit is amazing.
This is great.
Unbelievable bullshit.
Yeah.
But, yeah, in all seriousness, he really couldn't improvise at all. And, I mean, we were out of his league, so we said, you know what, we'll write some stuff.
So we walked away and came back 2 seconds later with a full script for him, and we just improvised around him.
We said, take a look at the script, and we'll cover you, I believe is quote-unquote what we said. We'll cover you.
We'll do the work for you is another way of what we said.
We get that. We run the
mill. Don't have to tell us anything. We run the mill.
And it's hard because, like, we're kind of as characters beneath him in this scene.
Right.
And it's so hard because we're so much above him in real life that it's just kind of hard to act that much. It's hard to act that much.
Right, yeah. I think we do a good job acting inferior.
Jesus,
but
of course.
We're really trying to act inferior now as if we don't. We're kind of oblivious to his situation.
Because our characters are a new cab service, so we don't get the business. Well, we get the business, but our characters don't get the business.
Our characters don't really understand business. They don't understand where he's going to have this meeting in the middle of the night.
If us as people came into this...
Of course we know.
We knew where he's going in the woods.
We fucking wrote this bullshit.
We knew he was going to come out bloody.
Yeah, we wrote it.
We wrote it.
It's as simple as that.
It's as simple as that.
I'm pretty sure he just said, I'm
going to. It's funny to watch it and think, this is fucking insane.
And this is so much not like us in real life.
Yeah.
which is great.
Do you see that close up? I love that close up.
Great close up.
When we cut to him there, and
great close up.
And he's pretending as if he said something else. And again, we knew exactly what he said.
Right.
We knew what he said.
We wrote it.
His line.
But
we wrote his line.
We have to act. That's hard shit, people.
It's great. It's so funny to me
yeah.
that we're pretending as if we don't know what he said. Oh, what you? It sounded like you said this.
No.
You know?
I'm fucking dead. No.
Right.
We get it, guys. Jesus.
It's just hilarious. And then we're cutting to
exterior shots.
You got a little lens flare there as the car goes by. Yeah. Stuff that J.J. Abrams does, but really not well.
Yeah.
I think with a shot like that, we really master it.
And I think you knew J.J. before he was doing that, and you told him, like, hey, you might want to try this.
Right, because he was talking about all these big productions, big Hollywood kind of action suspense stuff he wanted to do, high octane stuff, and I said, you know, you might want to throw in some lens flares there, and
that was when you were rooming with him,
right?
When he was, yeah, he was just out of college, I think.
Yeah,
you were like in middle school.
Yeah,
which is great. That's
right,
crazy.
Yeah.
Like you're
we
the
don't
same.
Have to talk about that though. Everybody knows my past.
Right.
Come on. I mean, that's nice of you to bring that up, but come on.
I just want to make sure everyone knows that you knew about it.
No, I'm modest. Come on. Deep shit. So what's going on? I got wrapped up in our conversation. What's going on?
Looks like we're still driving.
Right, so we're still driving at this point. I'm fucking dead. What does that mean? There's the shot again. And again, we're acting as if we don't know what he said. This is the second time that happened. Mm-hmm. And, it's so funny to look back on that and think we wrote his line.
Right.
Of course we know what he said.
Yeah, this is it.
This is the address.
Doesn't really look like
so we use some Sam Cooke. We missed that while we were talking about
right,
JJ.
We use some
I don't know why we spent any time on JJ.
We used Sam Cooke. We cleared that sample. I spoke with his ghost, and he was great about it.
Yeah, he was really nice. Again, supernatural things. We're able to achieve some things because of supernatural ability. And we spoke to the dead.
Because we showed him a rough cut of the video, and he was laughing so hard
at it. I mean, how could you not, though?
I checked. I think we're the first video to get an afterlife comic response.
Right.
The afterlife love it.
Mm. Now, at this point, we're pretending as if we don't understand why he's going in the woods.
Mm-hmm.
And,
we have to act while in a parked car, which is another challenge. Usually we were moving before.
Can I say a little bit of a spoiler?
Sure.
You know what? You as the viewer, it's left a little bit ambiguous in this episode, but the episode we're going to come out with, I believe this summer, we're not sure when we're going to release it.
Right.
You're actually going to find out why he goes in the woods.
Right.
Which, I mean, I know your minds are blown at this point, and you don't understand what I'm talking about. You'll see.
Another element of suspense that the video now reveals later, a year later, is that now, after a year, you're finally going to find out what happened.
Right.
So we left you in suspense for a really long time, and that's just how much of geniuses we are.
I think you're going to like it. You want to listen to some of that?
Yeah.
No, I love this part. We're just sitting in the car. We're we're waiting for him. Very suspenseful stuff.
This could have been boring. We could have just been sitting there doing nothing. But we as filmmakers were like, no, let's keep it interesting.
Mm-hmm. We have this sequence with the music. It's very disorienting. We cut to the exterior shot. Now, in editing, we really wanted this to be as if it's crazy how music really sets the vibe and the mood in a room, and then when you're outside of the room, you don't really understand what's going on in there.
It's kind of like when you hear a joke and you try and recite it later, and it's kind of like you had to be there.
Right, exactly.
Outside of the car, you're not there.
Mm.
So get in the car next time, buddy.
Right.
Stop. I don't know what the fuck you're doing outside the car in the first place.
Yeah, this is all. This is also a reference to Allegory of the Cave, because.
Oh, yeah.
When you're in the cave, our characters, they're so oblivious and they don't know what's going on.
You gotta find the sun.
Right, so. We're kind of in the cave while we're in the car, and I think that's really great stuff. I mean,
we also helped co-write Allegory of the Cave.
Yeah, that was a fun time.
Fun, I mean, 2 hours that we churned that one out.
And then
foot shot was important.
Right. Yeah. Well, one of our main.
We got a different guy to do the. We got a different guy to do the foot shot because I was not coming to the set that day to do a fucking foot shot. So we got a grip guy to do that.
Yeah, and Nike threw us a little bit of money, so we needed. I thought they were such douches for making us do that, but
a great shoe though, the Nike shoe. Right. I should put that one.
He actually falls there.
Right, he does.
Now
fall.
That was spontaneous filmmaking.
There was a lot of ice.
Kind of a Italian neorealism thing we're doing there, in which, you know, whatever happens on set, we're gonna roll with it. There, I literally hit into a wooden post.
That happened?
Fucked up the back of my car.
That's all for filmmaking, people.
And we just said, you know what, we're gonna do this, we're gonna keep it, we're gonna keep that shot. And I didn't regret scraping my car one bit.
Right.
I mean, if you're gonna do a little bit of Italian neorealism, you have to
get dirty.
You gotta get dirty, exactly.
Also, another supernatural element. We fixed the car, no problem. So we it really wasn't a big
just
deal.
Just took a wave of the hand.
Yeah.
Now that shot, I love it. It really looks like he's crying
and bleeding and everything.
And now that was actually a biblical reference we were making with that shot.
Also, we knew that he wasn't that great an actor, so we actually cut him up to get a real reaction from the blood.
And he cried. He was really crying.
Yeah.
But we said, you know what, we have to do this if we want the video to be as dramatic as we want it.
And this is kind of real anger because I just don't like him as an actor, so it was kind of easier to pull this one.
Right. And we tortured the guy on set so we could get
the that's the only way we're getting
the
performance out of him.
And I mean, he had quite an ego to him. He thought he was such an amazing actor. And And he asked for so much money. We told him we didn't want to do a high-budget film, and he was still asking for so much money.
I think like 2.5 mil he was looking for.
Yeah, I don't know the
per
exact
second.
Number. Was it
I think
that?
Per second of
was
film.
That?
Yeah.
But we said, you know what, we're trying to make something genuine and real. You're either going to get dirty with us, as you eloquently said before. That was amazing.
Thank you.
That you did that.
Just off the top of the head, I said that one.
And we convinced him. He said, you know what, I'll take a little under a million, and we granted him that.
Yeah.
So at this point, we're back. The cab service didn't go well.
Did not
obviously.
Work out. And, I mean, it was actually going to be a much longer bit about the cab service. It was going to be 2 hours on the cab service, but I just wanted that fucking guy off the set, so we just cut that bit
couldn't
short.
Couldn't stand him. Yeah.
In the scene that you watched before, we just threw him out of the actual set and the movie entirely. He actually had many more days of shooting to go, but I just couldn't take it. We still haven't paid him, actually.
Yeah, we did have so much more in mind for that sequence, and I mean, there was going to be a lot of philosophical points brought up. There was going to be some amazing discourses on gender roles and
in the third hour
marriage, but
in the third hour we find Bigfoot.
Right, yeah, that was kind of amazing stuff.
And we had to tell Bigfoot to not show up.
Right.
Which sucked.
And that was all about colonialism and stuff like that. But we had to cut it.
Yeah.
So
sorry you're not gonna see Bigfoot, guys, but blame that fucking asshole in the backseat.
Now we do kind of have, I mentioned the gay marriage discourse that we were going to bring up, but then had to cut. We do kind of have a homosexual thing going on here, and it stuff we do here, I mean, you haven't seen it at this point in the video, but obviously we make a sitcom, and then we use the gay character, and people are actually laughing so much at the gay character.
Right.
And it really is just representing how homophobic our society is.
Yeah.
That's what this is all about. This last bit is really speaking for the homosexuals in our society.
Right. Again, personal. We know gay people.
Yeah.
So that's why we can write about this kind
of
stuff.
I mean, some of my friends are homosexuals.
My father's gay.
Is he?
Yeah.
When did you find that out?
Yesterday.
It's just gotta be something like really ironic and obvious that he's
right, like, oh,
so like, yeah, like Two and a Half Men. Let's just
2.5 Men. Mm. Total straight guy. I love it.
Yeah.
So we mentioned 2.5 Men there, and that kind of goes with how the straight white male is really just collecting power and keeping it in our society. And I mean, the two of us are obviously straight white male men.
Yeah. Well, but, yeah, we had a brief career as male men.
Bathtub game, blind love between them.
What?
Like, don't talk about.
Oh,
yeah.
Fun guys.
We now they like shower mailmen.
Weird lovers.
Now they're like, we were never mailmen.
Guys that just.
I was just referring to our genders as.
Oh, mailmen.
Yeah, right. We're male men.
Yeah.
Totally just
so that versions. Makes it seem like, well, we don't understand the hardships right. of. No, we did some research for this video. We went to the ghetto, I think they say.
Yeah.
We went to the ghetto.
The gay-to.
Gay-to.
Mm-hmm.
We saw some shit.
Yeah, I mean, you could say that.
There was just like a lot of shit on the ground. I think some dudes were shitting on the ground. And we helped clean it up. We brought some bags. And... we cleaned up the ghetto. Yeah, it was cool. We're going to do a CCFC, cleans up the ghetto, but we just decided to use it as inspiration for this
right,
video.
Right, yeah. We were going to do a whole documentary on that, actually.
Yeah.
But, I mean, you just get so busy sometimes.
Yeah.
This shot, we're cutting back and forth from me doing a very silly face, and
yeah.
it's... It's a funny thing.
It's really funny. It's a genius look. And to hold it, that's not the same shot. He held that.
It's not easy to
do.
Yeah,
no.
It was hurting my face to make that face.
I bet it was.
It just doesn't seem to like fit in with mm-hmm. our show. It's kind of like key lime pie is more of a mainstream dessert. So yeah, maybe.
Right, and here we're talking about mainstream culture and the key lime pie.
Key lime pie, that was an interesting little bit.
And I don't know how much we should let out about that, because that's...
I'll just say another personal story.
Right, yeah. And we really wanted that to be left up to the viewer's interpretation, so...
Right, so why even talk about that anymore?
Yeah.
I will also say... It does have to do with our career as mailmen.
Right,
I'll reveal that much.
That's true.
But that's as far as I'm going with that. There was nudity.
Mm.
And picking up some poop.
Okay. We now go to a different musical montage.
Right.
Here we're using some electronic music.
Mm-hmm.
I forget the name of the band we used here, but... I think James Murphy was in it, and we called James.
Called James up?
He was another one who completely approved of the video.
Well, he was heavily influenced by our stuff, so...
Right, and we also were talking about the homophobic discourse we had going on there, and I know he's very supportive of the gay rights movement, so...
Very supportive.
I knew we would be able to get him on board with this video and let us use.
When we went to talk to him, he was actually blowing a guy, so he obviously is very into the...
Yeah, that was weird.
That was weird that he couldn't just stop for a second to talk to us. We just asked him if we could use the song, and he just nodded as he still had the man's dick in his mouth.
I think he's doing well now. He just produce that Reflector mm-hmm. People album.
He's doing well.
Because it seemed like he was having a hard time when we met up with him, but I also heard he has some coffee stuff going on. I don't know if that's true. He's doing a coffee thing, coffee beans.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
For him.
Yeah, I mean, it's good for him, but it seems misguided.
Yeah, it's inventive.
Really, just he's got to find himself. And
that's true.
I think whatever band we used, that band that he was in, that was pretty good.
Yeah.
But
maybe coffee's better, though. I would say don't stick to the music for him. Don't stick
and,
to the music.
And I believe he did break that band up.
Good, good.
Yeah, because obviously it's not quite up to par with some of the other music that is going on nowadays.
Like, when I listen to music and judge it, I just compare it to the music that we make.
Right, yeah.
And then I'm like,
I mean, like, this theme song.
Perfect timing.
Perfect timing. Great timing.
So, yeah, if you compare any music to stuff like this that we write, of course it's not up to par. So go back and write some new stuff and just try and compete. You won't. It's two
men. Right, here
that was just a theme song we threw together in a couple seconds.
It was a couple seconds. It really was.
Yeah.
I mean, we used a guitar track, a drum track, and that, again, very organic stuff coming from us, very natural, genuine, just kind of spitballing. We were singing. I made up that melody on the spot.
Mm-hmm.
And Adam said the two men thing.
Right.
Which, it went great.
Yeah.
With, the rest of the theme song.
Yeah.
And we didn't work that out, how we would vocalize different parts, where I would sing the first part and then he would come in at the end.
Like, again, we wanted to keep it real and mm-hmm. very small. Like, originally we had a choir
right,
singing.
Right, yeah. And
a horn section.
We scrapped that.
We were the choir and we mm-hmm. played all the horns ourselves, but we were like, it's too big.
Yeah, the sound was just over the top, and we didn't want to go for that. So now you're getting a look into the sitcom, which we're actually watching on the computer.
Mm-hmm.
I hope you as viewers can realize that's what's going on right now.
Mm-hmm.
Because we shot and edited this sitcom together, and now this is the commercial we do for the cool cabbies, and that's kind of interesting.
Yeah. We're very nice, and we have chocolate
cake, and we're cool guys. We're cutting to different shots. This is a pretty funny sequence.
And
we're smiling at the camera like children.
Yeah.
I great stuff here.
A lot of fun.
Yeah. Come on in. I really like how we're both dressed in hoodies. I thought that was a great idea for us to do.
Well, a lot of thought went into the wardrobe for this video.
Yeah, the wardrobe stuff was it was time consuming.
Time consuming.
You gotta do it.
We made all these clothes by hand. These are not store bought. We picked the cotton ourselves.
Yeah.
And everyone was satisfied.
Yeah, and my hoodie, I don't know about yours, but my hoodie I made to look as if I bought it at a store like Urban Outfitters.
I think I made mine to look like I bought it at American Eagle.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Yeah, because we wanted to make our own clothes to be genuine about it, but we wanted to make the clothes as if we bought them at a store because...
And I didn't finish the pants. That's as far as I can get on the pants. That should be a little longer, but I didn't have time before we started shooting.
Now, these clothes are made to seem as if we bought them at a store because we're bringing in a discourse of consumerism.
Yes.
Which I believe Kanye West was influenced by quite a bit because on the most recent album he did, Yeezy, I forget the name of that.
Yep,
but, Yeezy. He has a lot of thematic things going on about consumerism and classism, and I don't know if he did any homophobia stuff, but if he did, obviously he's a huge fan of ours, and watch this video. I think that one song where he's sampling that lady singing about black bodies swinging in the summer breeze or something. That I think that's some homophobic stuff going on there. So
I think breeze is supposed to be equated to man dick.
Mm.
Yeah, man dick. Right now.
Right, and then
surprise ending here. Whoa, there it is. No. That was like a fun little twist. Another little bit of suspense.
Yeah, and it's scary because you're left with what happened here.
Yeah.
Did he murder him? Did that character murder the other character? It must have been so gruesome.
Right. If you really think about the after of that, blood everywhere.
But you know what's scarier than seeing the blood and seeing all that happen?
Not seeing it?
Not seeing it.
Yeah.
Just it being left up to imagination. I mean, that's horrifying. That's the kind of thing you lie in bed at night and,
just lie. You just lie in bed.
Yeah. Because he can't fall asleep. It's
scary. Oh, yeah.
It's kind of bad. That was a pilot episode.
So, at this point, our characters realize the sitcom didn't work out either. And, which is so ironic because the two of us have a sitcom ourselves, the CCFC television series that we're commenting on. And
yes.
It's so funny to see us, you know, be upset over a sitcom that didn't work out when we really have a successful sitcom going on here.
And that is it.
Yeah, that's the commentary. Thanks for watching, everybody.
A lot of fun. I had a lot of fun.
I did too.
I think this cleared up a bunch of stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Just showcased our genius, who we are as people.
Some of the themes that went on during the episode and some of the symbolic stuff in the shots, I think you probably saw and heard from this commentary session that you never would have noticed.
Right.
Otherwise.
All right, well, I think that's about it.
Thanks, everybody.
Thank you very much.
I'm looking forward to you all seeing our next episode.
Thanks.